Dear friends and followers, welcome back to my channel. Today I'll be answering another very important question. Joe, in many videos I can hear the pilots say this while performing a takeoff.
V1, rotate. V2.
So what is all this? These three speeds play a major part during takeoff roll, so let's look at them in closer detail.
South 1383, runway 27, clear takeoff. United 1538.
Okay, first to know, this again is a basic introduction about takeoff speeds. The speeds we're talking about today will always follow in that order. V1, VR or rotate, and V2. And these speeds apply no matter if you're sitting in a little twin engine Cessna or a Boeing 747, the speed definition is for either plane the same. Okay, let's look at V1. Imagine yourself in the cockpit of your plane and applying takeoff thrust to your engine, and as you gently accelerate down the runway, you come to a point where you reach V1. So by the book, V1 is defined as the speed beyond which the takeoff should no longer be aborted, meaning that in case you experience any trouble with your plane before reaching V1, the classic example would be an engine failure, you would immediately abort your takeoff and would apply all necessary matters to bring the aircraft to a stop. Although the use of full reverse thrust is not mandatory. I'll come back to that in a second. So in this video here, this Airbus A319 applied takeoff thrust and due to a technical malfunction had to abort the takeoff prior reaching V1. Just listen to the sound of the engines. Now, the auto brake system comes active and immediately applies pressure to the brake cylinders. The ground spoilers are deployed, so are the reversers, and the plane and crew come to a safe stop on the runway. The smoke you can see here is coming from the brakes, as they are the primary force slowing down the aircraft. Now, let's say there were to be an engine failure, so one of the reversers would be inoperative, and therefore full reverse thrust can't be added to the braking measures, as mentioned before. Because V1 needs to be calculated prior every takeoff, taking into account airplane weight, runway length, wing flap setting, engine thrust used, runway surface contamination and environmental factors, and even the aircraft brakes, to assure yourself that any given failure prior reaching V1, you'll have enough runway left over to come to a complete stop. Now, if it's just a minor failure, you can continue the takeoff, but that's a whole nother video about the stop or go decision making. And besides that, this is one of the reasons why the captain keeps his hands on the throttle until the pilot monitoring calls out V1, and then he moves his hands away from the throttle to not inadvertently abort the takeoff after V1 in case of a failure. So in case you experience any serious malfunction after V1, you would have to commit yourself to continue the takeoff, otherwise a takeoff abort will lead to a runway overrun and could severely damage your plane. Next speed to call out is VR, or better known as rotate. By the book, VR is defined as the speed at which the pilot begins to apply control inputs to cause the aircraft nose to pitch up, after which it will leave the ground. Again, VR is also calculated prior takeoff in accordance with aircraft weight, environmental factors, etc. And it's the point where the generated lift over the wings becomes higher than the aircraft weight, keeping it on the ground. Easiest way to memorize VR is the point where the nose wheel leaves the ground and vortexes are created at the wingtips, which rotate behind the aircraft. And the point where the main gear leaves the ground, that's the point where you have reached VLOF, the liftoff speed. Next speed is V2. Now, some airliners still have the standard operating procedures to call out V2. Please comment below if you fly for such airline. It would be great to know. Okay, again, by the book, V2 is defined as takeoff safety speed, the speed at which the aircraft may safely climb with one engine inoperative. Okay, let's go back to all engines operative. Now imagine all is normal, you take off and someone would measure your height above ground at the end of the runway, like in this picture here. The height measured is the so-called screen height. Now let's get back to V2 and our engine failure situation. In case one engine fails, you need to maintain the speed of V2 in order to leave the runway at a screen height of 35 feet or higher and maintain the climb rate at V2 to be clear of obstacles in the departure sector. And you should be able to maintain that speed and climb rate until reaching one engine out acceleration altitude, where you then gain speed and retract the slats and flaps and continue with the emergency procedures.
This video here is a great example for V2. As you can see, the Boeing 757 hit a bird just after liftoff and the engine was severely damaged. The pilots maintained V2 and the respective climb rate, retracted the gear and performed all the necessary emergency procedures, flew a traffic pattern and landed the airplane safely.
The reason therefore is when local authorities design departure routes including obstacle avoidance procedures, they predict that your aircraft is at least capable of maintaining V2 with one engine and the gear retracted and guarantee obstacle collision protection. But trust me, there's a little bit more to it, so this was just a basic explanation of V2. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this short little video about the takeoff speeds. Next week's video will be all you need to know about the ram air turbine, so stay tuned for that. And tomorrow I'll be uploading my 100,000 follower thank you video, so please make sure to check that out because I need your feedback on that video. You'll see why. Thanks for your time. See you next Thursday. Make sure to subscribe to my channel and check out my Instagram account at FlyWithCaptainJoe. All the best, your Captain Joe.